The Lord, friends, wherever you are, I know we are speaking to people across the globe. Friends, I'm very delighted and very excited to be online on the online church lunch hour. And every time God gives us opportunity to be in His presence, it is a special day. And just allow me to declare that today is special in your life. This hour is special for you, because every time, every minute in the presence of the Lord is special. Friends, my name is Reverend David Martin Munoga from Christ is Cathedral Bugembe in Busoga Diocese, where I serve as the assistant vicar and also the ICT coordinator at Busoga Diocese. I'm very blessed and bless the name of the Lord that I was given this opportunity to share with you, men and women of God, wherever you are. I am married. My wife is Sisi Munoga, and she is online. I saw her online. I believe she's at home. God has blessed us. Our union has been now 8 years so far. Our union so far, God has given us two fruits of the womb, two boys. And we are still in the business of adding spiritual children and physical children by the grace of God. I want to thank the Lord for my brother David Hilome, who's in South Korea right now. We met at UCU, and I thank the Lord that we are still standing in ministry. He was ahead of us. And I want to say hello to everyone who's online, people and the leadership. We thank the team that has led us in the praise and worship. Reverend Simon, you bless my soul every time you're on the microphone. God bless you. I know internet is a challenge to us, but we believe by the grace of God, we shall overcome. And I pray that it shall stabilize and all of us shall get the word of the Lord in clarity. Friends, let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the opportunity that you have given us to sit at your feet. We thank you, Father, because you ordained it before the foundations of the earth were formed, that we shall sit at your feet, King of Kings, to listen to your word, to learn from you, to praise your name, and Lord, to glorify you. Father, even as we are going to share in your word, we pray that the word of the Lord shall come to every one of us through the different devices we are using in clarity and in the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray that I shall be nothing but just a vessel that shall bring out the message of the Lord. May I speak only that you have predestined that I speak, that your people shall learn, and may this word be a seed to a fertile ground, which is everyone's heart, that it shall grow and bear fruit. We pray, believing and trusting in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Praise the Lord once again. Friends, our theme of this week is praying without ceasing. And I want to thank every person that has shared. We thank Bishop who preached on Monday and my colleagues who preached on Tuesday and Wednesday. And today the Lord has given us another opportunity to share in the message of the word. We are talking about today's topic is persisting in prayer. Persisting in prayer. And just like we took our reading from the book of Luke, the gospel according to Luke, chapter 18, verse 1 to 8. Those who have just joined, our topic is persisting in prayer, and we took our reading from Luke, chapter 18, reading from verse 1 to 8, and we thank the Lord for that. Friends, prayer is one of the key aspects that define a Christian life. Prayer is one of the key aspects that define a Christian life. And what is prayer? I know it has been defined by one of the simplest ways of defining prayer or understanding prayer is that prayer is a dialogue between God and people, and especially His covenant people. When you come to the Lord in Christ Jesus, you are a covenant child of God. You are a covenant person of God. And prayer makes more meaning when you are communicating to God, when you are in a covenant, when you are in agreement, when you are in testament with Him. And that is through Jesus Christ, His only Son and our Savior. Prayer is a major theme in the Bible. You know, we're a Bible-believing church, And the Bible is from the Bible that we get our doctrine, we get our inspiration, we get our teaching. It is a major theme in the Bible, both in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. It is demonstrated both in word and in deed. When you look at the Bible from the beginning of the history of our salvation, when you look at the nation of Israel, it was birthed out of prayer. When Abraham was crying to God that he has no heir, that Eliezer, who was just a servant in his house, is the one who's going to take over after him. God told him, no, you'll have children, and there will be as many as the stars in the sea. And out of that, we see the nation of Israel. God, in the Bible, in the Old Testament, heard the cries of the children of Israel when they were in slavery. And the Bible says he heard their cries when the Hebrew children went to Egypt. That was a prayer. And God, with his strong hand, he came and delivered them. When Moses was sent by God, on a number of occasions, Moses often conversed with God in prayer and in intercession for the children of Israel. So like I was saying, that it is demonstrated both in word and in deed in the Old Testament. When you look at men like David, men like Elijah, men like Jeremiah, men like Solomon, they prayed to God, and their lives were defined by prayer. And David, the author of many Psalms, when you look at many Psalms, they demonstrate prayer. So, like I said, that prayer is a very, very, very important aspect in the life of a Christian, which is seen in the Bible, both in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. And when you look at the New Testament, whose major character is Jesus Christ, his example of teaching about prayer inspires us to pray. And when we focus on our theme, which is got from the book of Luke, chapter 18, where Jesus was teaching his disciples about prayer, we also see that one of the key themes in the book of Luke is prayer. You know, every book has got a message, and there are key themes in each and every message, every book of the Bible. But when you look at the book of Luke, prayer is one of the key themes in that book. And it is given that believers are to live a life of prayer. That can summarize it all when Luke talks about prayer. Now, in Luke's narratives, prayer occurs at every point of Jesus' life. Just to give you a few examples, at his baptism, in Luke chapter 3, verse 21, the Bible says, as he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit came down upon him in a bodily form of a dove. It was after his baptism that he was praying, and the Holy Spirit came. That was, Jesus was beginning his ministry. And at the selection of the 12 disciples, when you look at Luke chapter 12, chapter 6, reading verse 12, he spent the whole night praying on the mountain before choosing the 12 disciples. So you can see that Jesus' life was defined by prayer. We continue to see at his transfiguration, Jesus prayed. When he told the disciples, "Watch with me." It was a time of agony, it was a time of praying, and Jesus was believing God for many, many things. Praise be to God. When we look at Jesus teaching on the Lord's Prayer, it is also something worth noting that is emphasizing the point of prayer in the book of Luke. Now, when you look at Luke 18, where we've got our message, Jesus uses a parable of a widow and a corrupt judge to teach us about persistence in prayer. Jesus was deliberate on each and every parable that he used. He brings this story. The Bible says, then Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray and not give up. That is verse 1 of Luke 18. He wanted to teach us. He wanted to teach the disciples. And he used to use figures of speech. He used allegories. He used the parables to bring out the message in a way that can be easily understood. Then this particular one, he demonstrated it by the parable of a widow and a judge. The Bible talks about this judge, that there was this town, and there was this judge who neither feared God nor cared about men. And there was a widow in that town who kept coming to him with the plea, grant me justice against my adversary. A widow had adversary, and it looks here that it was only this judge that would bring justice to this lady against her adversary. Listen to me, friends. Why does Jesus use a widow in this case? First of all, women in the Hebrew culture were not counted as, were not really valued the way we see women today, especially in our land. Even when they were taking census, women were not counted. Remember in the Bible when Jesus fed 5,000 men? The narrative says he fed 5,000 men and children. Women were not counted. Yet we know very well that in many gatherings where Jesus was, there were women. So by the mere fact that this widow, first of all, she's a widow. Second, she's a woman. It shows the vulnerability of this lady. A widow was even worse. Being a woman was not just bad. But again, being a widow made it worse. At least you could be a woman when you are married. It was at least known that your husband could help you. But now this was a widow. She's not just a woman. She's a widow. She's helpless. She's weak. She's inferior. And now she has got a challenge. She needs someone to stand in as a judge and bring justice. She had adversaries. Whatever case was there, she needed a judge. But the Bible is very clear that this particular judge respected no man. She did not care about any man. And she feared no God. You can imagine. You are helpless. Then you land in the hands of a judge who fears no man and doesn't even fear God. Chances are high there that you may not get justice. But listen to me. A widow represents the poor, the needy, and the oppressed. And it is you and me. Jesus was speaking to these people, knowing that in the communities, there are people who are needy, who may not even afford court rates. There are people who are needy, who may not attract any attention of someone to help them. No one can even look at them with mercy. There are people who are poor, that they are marginalized in the society. There are people who are looked at as people who cannot even afford anything. And because of that, they are oppressed, their land is taken. So the widow in this particular context is a representative of those people who are like me, who are like you, who are helpless at times. At times you need money and you don't have it, you are helpless at that time. At times you need a name that you put in the front before maybe doors are open for you. When you don't have such a person, when you don't have, these days they call them godfathers, you may not have a godfather and you may need him or her at that particular point in life. If you're in such a state, you are like a widow in the Bible. There are times when we need people in our lives and we can't them. We can't get them. There are times when we need help and instead of getting help, we are oppressed because of our background. We are oppressed because they know we are weak. We are oppressed because they know we cannot fight back. And the enemy takes advantage of that to oppress you here and there. Listen to me. The description of this judge shows he showed no special respect towards anyone, whether great or small. And Jesus is up to a point here. He's not just throwing parables for the sake of it. He's comparing the widow to us who pray. And he puts this particular judge, he compares him with God. Jesus is not in any way saying that God is corrupt. No. But the conclusion when he says that, and the Lord said, listen to what the unjust judge says, and will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? I tell you, he will see that they get justice and quickly. Praise be to God. Jesus compares this judge to whom people go for justice and he's corrupt. He doesn't fear anyone. He doesn't even fear God. But he says, how much more God who is not corrupt, God who created you, God who loves you, God who calls you by name, if you go to him, if this judge was able to answer, was able to respond, was able to help this widow who was helpless, who had nothing to give as a bribe. If he feared no God, there was no way this judge would even fear this widow. But the Bible says, after persistence in prayer, the judge says, let me help this lady, lest that he will, you know, if I don't help her, maybe she will eventually wear me out with her coming. How much more if we pray persistently to God that our loving God shall not say, I'm tired of this. Because our judge, our God is not like this judge. He's our lawgiver, he's our judge, but he's the one who helps us. Praise be to God. Now, in demonstrating that, we should pray and not lose heart. Jesus compares this widow to us. He's telling us if this widow was able to get help, we should pray without ceasing. We should persist in prayer and we should not lose heart. Jesus identifies us with this widow. And at times I think we are helpless. Now, Jesus is saying, if persistence pays off with the corrupt human of limited power, listen to this, is powerful. Jesus is telling us, if persistence pays off with this corrupt human who has limited power, how much more will it pay off with a just God of infinite power? Praise be to God. Listen to me, friends. When we are going to persist in prayer, we must have a reason why we persist. This lady knew her weakness. This lady knew her helplessness. This lady knew the background she had, but she said, I don't care what society says. I don't care what has been tagged against my name. I don't care what people think of me. I'll go to this man because I know he's the only one in this city who can give me justice. But remember, he's a corrupt man. He had all the reasons to put off his file, her file. But listen to me. Jesus is teaching us a lesson here that if justice could be given by this corrupt judge, how much more could God, who has infinite power, who is able to command the heavens, God who is able to heal the sick, God who is able to hold the heavens without pillars, how much more shall we receive help from him? Friends, that should be reason enough for you not to give up in prayer. That should be reason enough for you not to surrender. That should be reason enough for you not to lose heart in prayer. Now, the purpose of this parable is to encourage us Christians, friends, you and me, we should be encouraged to persevere in our faith against all odds. Hallelujah. When you talk about persisting in faith, you know, when you are going to pray, prayer is fueled by faith. It is through faith that we can pray. The other day, Bishop Paul was preaching about faith in Christ, and we were told that prayer is fueled by faith. Hallelujah. So when you have faith coupled with persistence, nothing can stop you. Faith coupled with persistence in prayer, nothing will fail you. And the example of this widow is just demonstrated as Jesus was teaching. Now, to persist means to continue in opinion. Listen to this, friends. To persist means to continue in a particular opinion. You hold a particular opinion about something and you say, I will not change. You hold it continually. Or you continue on course of a certain action in spite of difficulty or opposition. When we talk about prayer without ceasing and persisting in prayer, we're not saying that life is going to be simple. Every time you want to pray, oh my God, I wake up every time at 3 and pray. Every day is going to be beds of roses. No. Sometimes there are oppositions. Sometimes there are difficulties. Yet you have to pray. God says pray without ceasing. You want to pray, but there's this distraction. You want to pray, there's this opposition. You want to pray, they're just pulling you here and there. There are worries of the world. There are worries that come to us in life. Now, to persist is to continue on a course of action in spite of difficulty or opposition. Friends, I'm not here to tell you that it's so simple. It is so smooth. Every time you want it to happen. No, even when Jesus went with the disciples to pray at the transfiguration, the Bible says he came back 3 times praying over the same thing. And he told them, friends, can you watch with me? The first time he found them asleep. The second day before they must sleep. I told, can't you even watch with me for even 1 hour? Even 1 hour. Sleep would be a problem, like it was for these disciples. It can be the opposition to prayer. But the Bible is telling us that if you are going to persist, is to continue on course of action in spite of difficulty or opposition. What is that that tries to hinder your prayer? Have you been giving up every time you go to the altar and you begin to say, oh, I think let me go and sleep. My brother, my sister, I'm here to encourage you. Persist. I'm here to encourage you. Don't give up. I don't care which names you have been called. I don't care what has been tagged on your name. Persist in prayer, because persistence coupled with faith breaks walls and you see breakthrough. Hallelujah. Now, in this particular parable, there are three difficulties. In life, there are difficulties that may hinder our prayer. For example, we have day-to-day worries of life. I'm telling you, my brother, there are times when you are broken down by words. Someone can tag a word against your name. At times, you feel like not even going to the public. But I'm here to tell you, the hymn that was ushering this message said, take it to the Lord in prayer. Do your friends despise, forsake you? And sometimes you feel like you are forsaken. People that you have stood with for all these years, I don't care who has forsaken you. Our God never forsakes us. It's not like this judge is the one who loves us. He says, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. And the song says, take it to him in prayer. I don't care what worries you. I don't care what weighs you down. If God can give you the grace to persist, my brother, my sister, you'll see victory in the name of Jesus. Sometimes you have demonic oppositions. They just don't want to see that people pray. Because every time we go on the altar to pray, every time we speak a word in prayer, it is fire in the camp of the enemy. So the enemy also does whatever it takes to see that he resists your prayer. But I'm saying, I don't care what the enemy says. I don't care what the opposition does. If you have determined, persist, and God will give you the grace. Sometimes you have no breakthrough moments. You feel you have prayed for enough time. You feel you have taken this to the Lord for a number of years. Let me tell you, friends, when I got married 8 years ago, my desire and wish was to get a baby immediately. After 9 months, after wedding, have a child, grow with your children. But it didn't happen immediately, friends. I want to tell you, I prayed. My wife is a witness. We prayed. He said, I don't care. I'll speak to God. People spoke. The enemy would whisper. But through prayer, God gave us a son after 3 years. I'm here to encourage you. You might be on this platform and you are believing God for a child. And you have said, it is 10 years now, Lord, I'm giving up. It is 3 years, Lord, I'm giving up. It is 5 years, I'm giving up. There are people I know who have spent over 20 years and God has remembered them. Remember, we are saying to persist is to continue on a course of action in spite of difficulty. Delay may be a difficulty. Delay may appear like opposition, but like we know, delay is not denial. God, at an opportune time, when he persists in prayer, he will remember us. Praise be to God. Now, no matter what seems to hinder your prayer, Jesus says, persist. Don't give up. Push on. Just go to the place and say, Lord, here I am. Let me tell you, at times it's difficult. But if you've created a place of altar and you feel like it's too much for you, I always tell people when I teach about prayer that you can just go in that place and kneel and say, Father, I am here. You may not even have the words, but the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord teaches us with groanings that cannot even be uttered. You may even fail to speak a word. Remember the Hannah experience when she was at the altar praying and Eli said, this lady is drunk. The Bible says her lips were moving, but she was not even speaking. Just go to the altar. Just go before the presence and say, Father, I'm here. You can even just prostrate there in surrender. God sees the heart of prayer. Sometimes it's not about what is coming out of your mouth, but the attitude, the faith, the heart, the mind, God will value, God will see, and he will answer your persistence. He will answer your prayer. He will answer the faith that you come with in prayer. Persistence in prayer, according to this text that we have just read, suggests three things that I want us to conclude with. Number one, If you are to persist in prayer, you must have a mental attitude of prayerfulness. That's what it means to persist in prayer. The mentality that you have about prayer should be of people who pray. That at any moment you can speak to your father. You're in a taxi. Your mentality says, I can pray from here. You should not be in this particular box that until I face a certain direction, until I'm in a certain place, oh, I have to go to the altar. If I'm a priest, I fast to robe, then put on my stole. Now people like me who is a deacon, you tight very well like a deacon. Then you face a certain, you know, in even a certain posture. No, your mentality as a person who persists should be the attitude of prayerfulness. That is number one key. Jesus is telling us here, if you are going to be a person who persists in prayer, you must have that particular mentality that at any time I can pray. I don't care where I am. I don't care in which direction I'm facing. I can speak to God. Point number two, persistence in prayer also suggests that continual personal fellowship with God is key. People who persist in prayer should have a continuous personal fellowship with God. You cannot be a person of persistent prayer when you only speak to God when you're in church. Until that time when they say we are entering a moment of intercession, everyone speak to your God. And from Sunday to Sunday, in between that, there's nothing like prayer. No, people who persist in prayer, they have that fellowship. Because remember we say that prayer means dialogue between God and his covenant people. So if you're going to be a person of prayer, you must have that time. Continually, you are in a fellowship. And when you're in fellowship with God, you must be in agreement. It is people who are in agreement that move together. If we are to move together with God, because we pray to God, and he's the one who answers prayer. So if we are going to be people of prayer, persistent prayer, our fellowship must be at 100%. Our fellowship must be continuous. We should always desire. We should always yearn to listen to him. Through his word, what is God speaking to me? What does he require of me? What am I? Can I do to praise him? What can I do to worship him? That is the continuous fellowship we are talking about. Praise be to God. And point number three, you must have consciousness of being in God's presence throughout each day. You must have consciousness of being in God's presence throughout each and every day. Praise be to God. You're just conscious. Sometimes one was challenging us, and when you say, Father, we are before you, we come before you, and he asked the question, where have you been? If you are coming before the Lord now, where have you been? It's quite challenging. But you should have that consciousness that you are in the presence of God. Why? Because prayer goes hand in hand with holiness. Persistence in prayer goes in hand in hand with living a righteous life. So you should always have that consciousness that where I am I in fellowship? Am I in righteousness? Am I in holiness? Am I living a life that pleases God? It should be in your consciousness. If there's anything that stumbles you, be repentant. Say, Father, I'm sorry. I come to you with a humble and contrite heart. And the Bible says it is such a sacrifice of humility and contriteness that the Lord shall not despise. So you should thus be conscious that you are in the presence of God at all times. Friends, as I conclude, you need to know that persisting in prayer does not necessarily mean long-winded attempts that try to manipulate God. No. It's not about manipulating God. No. It's not about speaking so many words. No. It's not about twisting the hand of God, but having the attitude, having the mind that you operate in the will of God. It is trusting our Father and not our eloquence. Trust and prayer are twins. You cannot go to God. Even the Bible says that those who come to God must believe that he is. So trust, faith, and in our Father is very, very key if you are going to be people who persist in prayer. And I want to conclude with this quote from one of my favorite authors, Leonard Ravenhill. Listen to what he said. I want to read it to you very clearly. Ravenhill says, when he's teaching about prayer in his book, Why Revival Tarries, if you have a pen, note this. He said, no man is greater than his prayer life. My sister, the way you look is your prayer life. I know you are still in God's workshop, but as you persist, as you pursue, your faith is developed through prayer. So the level of your faith is directly proportional to your prayer life. No man is greater than his prayer life. The pastor who is not praying is playing. I don't want to be playing pastor. I want to be praying pastor. Ravenhill says, I don't want to say pastors alone. A Christian who is not praying is playing. Listen to this. The people who are not praying are straying. If you are not praying, you are straying. When we persist in prayer, prayer puts us in the direction where we can follow the will of God. Prayer puts us in the direction where we can know the mind of God. Prayer aligns us with the will of God for our lives. So if we are not praying, we are straying. You may think you are preaching when you're not actually preaching, when you're just speaking your own things. Why? Because you have not been guided by God in prayer. So he says that the people who are not praying are straying. I pray that you shall not stray. Ravenhill continues to say that we have many organizers in churches, but few agonizers. Very many organizers, women conference organizer, prayer meetings organizer, of course, weddings, people organizing, but agonizers, to agonize me comes from the word agony. You go to God in prayer when you are agonizing out of pain and you are speaking to God. You are saying, Father, give us this city. Father, change us. Father, transform us. Father, bring revival. Let's not just be organizers of online church lunch hour. Let us be agonizers of this program, of this ministry, and the Lord will bless us. Hallelujah. He continues to say, there are so many singers, but few clingers. To cling is to get hold on to God. Is to get hold on to God. Let us not just be singers. I love my brother, Simon Peter, Reverend. He's a wonderful worshiper. I know he's a clinger. He's not just a singer, but he's a clinger. Worshippers must be clingers, must be seekers. It is through that the Lord anoints that you sing the same song and it touches people differently. Why? Because you cling unto God for inspiration and anointing that breaks yokes even as you worship. There are so many fears, few tears. Many fears, few tears. May we cry to the Lord day and night that there will be a change in our lives. There is much fashion and little passion. Much fashion, little passion. Are you a lady of fashion but not a lady of passion? I'm praying that the Lord God Almighty shall give you the grace to be a man of passion. Persistent in prayer requires passion. You must be passionate about prayer. Friends, there are so many interferers, few intercessors. So many interferers, few intercessors. Hallelujah. Anyone who is leading a church knows what I'm talking about. This one comes to interfere with this ministry. When you rise up in prayer, they say, this one is spoiling the church. When you begin to speak tongues, oh, this one is lost. When you begin to preach in power, they said, this one is changing our doctrine. I'm here to tell you that don't just be an interferer in the church. Be an intercessor, and the Lord will bless you. And lastly, there are so many writers and few fighters. I'm not saying writing is bad. Don't just be a writer. Be a fighter. We fight in the spiritual realm. We don't fight physically. The weapons of warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God. The pulling down of strongholds. People who pull down strongholds are men and women of prayer. Friends, as we continue in prayer, that the Lord shall give us the grace. I don't know what has discouraged you, but we say to be persistent, it is to continue in opinion or in the course of action against all odds. And I want to add, to produce results. My sister, don't give up. Don't cry. Take it to the Lord in prayer, and you'll see the deliverance of the Lord. God bless you. God bless you. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for your children. Thank you for the word that has come to us. I pray that this word shall grow in us, and many of us shall be inspired to pray. Many of us shall be inspired to persist, regardless of the difficulties and opposition. Because Jesus overcame, we shall overcome. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.